Very good afternoon to all of you, and welcome back to this very important webinar series that is conducted by Sri Lanka Medical Association. And this time the theme of our webinar series is breaking the chain of transmission through rational and scientific approach.
Briefly, if I would like to just to give an brief overview, all of us know last Sunday, last Saturday, there was a case detected in Gampa Hospital, but it is a very incidental finding on the surveillance of ILI, which is influenza-like illness screening, which has been going on for years now in hospitals. But it was incorporated to corona also almost about 3 months back. And patients who are coming to the OPD or sometimes admitted to a hospital, a selected hospitals, are screened. Generally about per day, about 10 or 15 samples are taken from those patients and the tests are done. So there has been this screening for many months now, about 3 months for ILI. But this is the first time in Gampa that they detected a corona positive patient. So that is how this whole thing came about last Sunday. And when the test results came positive, I think the system get activated to track that person to a garment factory in Minuangoda. So that is how the things worked. So what I want to tell is, so this detection is actually part of the screening process that has been on place. So that is one of the positive things of public health screening mechanism that we have in this country. So if you look at it's 6 days has passed basically. And when it was led to the one garment factory, the health staff, Ministry of Health with the epidemiology unit and others got activated, and it was tracked to the Minuangoda Brandix plant, and they started doing the PCR test and isolating and quarantine people. So you need to understand the numbers became very high within the first 4 days up to about Thursday, because that is the time that the screening reports came of those people who were employed there. Totally, it is around 1,500 who were working in that particular place. And within about 2 days, 2.5 days, all those were screened. But there has been a bit of a problem of tracking them within immediately, because some of the addresses, and there were a bit of a problem of that because of the management system had certain failures from the company side. So, however, what I understand by yesterday afternoon, we had a technical committee meeting also in the ministry. Now almost 99% of, by now it should be 100%, all those who were detected have already been traced and admitted to the hospital, and others who were from that place has been sent to quarantine centers, and it's been done. And when you look at how cases appeared in about 17 districts by now, you know that the people go on leave, and this is a huge factory. And this factory has other factories around the country. And those who have gone home was also traced. And that is how certain people were detected from different parts of the country. And they are already being taken into quarantine and tested. And because of that, then there are families around and neighbors around and places where they have visited. So those small pockets also has to be quarantined and tested for corona. So that is the process that is going on. So what I want to tell is, by now it is close to about 1,100 cases close from this particular cluster has been identified, and some reports are still coming. and this is the current status. But apart from that, there are a few things that I would like to mention. One is that some of these who have gone, particularly one employee has gone to a trip to Jaffna. That is why Jaffna involvement came, and that particular exposure group has been now quarantined and tested. And some of the spouses and their close associates have been working in certain hospitals. That is how, particularly the Horan Hospital, they had a case of a health worker. Then there has been an exposure to a health worker in Gampa Hospital, and so on. There are a few. So this is how things have come up. And now basically what I understand, the basic public health measures are being taken. And I think 99.99%, as far as I understand, has been traced back to someone in the Brandix plant. And what I understand, in the morning, there has been one case detected in Koggala Brandix plant. And I think there has been labor exchanges between certain places. It may be the cause. So basically, I don't think there is anything to panic, and panic will not help any one of us. And the things are being done, and we need the support of all to go forward from here.
Thank you, Krishanta. And we'll move into questions a little later. Now we'll be moving to the next presentation on the next speaker. Our next speaker is Dr. Bodhika Samarasekara. He's a rather special person at this moment because it was under his care that the first patient to be detected was identified. And so I would like, and also he's a respiratory physician as well. I would like to invite Dr. Bodhika Samarasekara to tell us how this first detection was made and what's the current situation, and also any specific instruction related to the management of the respiratory aspect of the disease. Over to you, Dr. Bodhika.
Thank you very much. Actually, during last 2 months, we didn't, even though there is no community spread, like our hospital, always like we had meetings regarding corona, and our respiratory ward, we have started the respiratory ward for a temporary basis. But even though disease is not there in the community, can you hear me?
Yes. Yeah. We can hear you.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Even though disease is not in the community, we thought of continuing this respiratory ward for another few months, because since we noticed that the countries like India, Bangladesh, and the other countries, there's an increased number of patients, and because of that, like there's people are moving to people are traveling to the sometimes to our country, like so we wanted to increase our surveillance, and we increase the number of random samples in the hospital. So in our ward also, like our team of doctors, like we all did a random sampling. This particular patient came with she's a 39 years old lady, came with fever for a few days and taken treatment from that particular government medical center, and then came to work. However, like then while on working, like she developed a chest pain. So in her history, like she had fever for 2 to 3 days, and cough and sore throat. So the PCU staff, because of the chest pain, they did a ECG, which was normal, and a chest X-ray was done. The chest X-ray, because of some overlying breast shadows were there, like they, the PCU staff thought like this is a pneumonia, so that's why they transferred the patient to the respiratory ward. We did clinical examination. There were no signs of pneumonia, and chest X-ray was normal. And however, like after coming to the ward, like the fever settled, and patient was perfectly normal. But as a concept of random sampling, we as after the discussion with the epidemiology unit that we continue this random sampling. And so that's how this patient was detected.
Thank you, Dr. Bodhik. And our as a member and the secretary of the College of the Respiratory Physicians, do you have any recommendations or suggestions for other doctors and other physicians regarding the management of the patients?
Yeah, so I mean, the patient management, like we have to increase the surveillance. All the patients with respiratory symptoms now need to have undergo this testing. So testing is the most important thing. And the monitoring of these patients are very important. Like saturation is very important factor because all the units now, they are the portable the pulse oximeters, even at OPD levels, we have to increase the surveillance. And so these patients need continuous monitoring and undergo chest X-ray at least. And so there are the other investigations that's like ultrasounds in the ward. The basic investigations and to be done. And specific management, like these patients can be directed to the respiratory unit or consultant physicians. And there are our other concern is how to deal with this with the other respiratory disease. Now, there are the other respiratory illnesses, give the continuous care of these patients. Like, as you all know, that chronic lung diseases like COPD, bronchiectasis, they are comorbidities, and these sort of patients are increased risk of developing complications of COVID. We have to manage these patients. And TB is a very important factor because of COVID last season, we have diagnosed about 28 TB patients who came with some similar symptoms to COVID. So we could trace these TB cases, and because TB, I think it's one of the most important disease. Even though we are considering this COVID, the TB deaths during this period, this 2020, there are about 21 deaths due to TB. So we have to continue our services, respiratory services, especially TB, because if there are if these patients defaulted, then there will be risk of developing multi-drug resistant TB as well. So specific management is a specific topic. We have to talk in detail later. Initially, the patients should be close monitoring is very important, and the chest X-ray, and if possible ultrasound. And we have to detect the important high risk patients. So initially, if there's saturation less than 92, we can give start low dose oxygen, 6 to 12 liters per minute, especially with the face mask. They don't recommend nasal cannulas or venturi mask. Now, specialized unit, if this is not improving, we have to direct these patients for high flow nasal oxygen also. If saturation is again not recovering, less than 92 and respirate more than 28, this patient's continuing dyspnea. So we have to go for a CPAP or NIV, which is available again in most of the many of respiratory units, and we have to improve the facilities of these patients. If these patients are responding to high flow oxygen, then you can continue high flow nasal oxygen. But failing that, we have to refer these patients for a higher care.
And we thank Dr. Ananda for joining this webinar, because as we are very much aware that he's very busy with we see at the moment with managing hundreds of patients. Over to you, Dr. Anand.
Thanks, Indika. You can hear me?
Yes, we can hear you clearly.
We haven't changed the case definition yet. I don't think we will change the case definition, but we are discussing about changing the definition for suspected patients. Actually tonight we are having a meeting on that. So hopefully by Monday we will be able to give the new definition, hopefully on the suspected cases. That means now those suspected cases means we have to test those patients. That's the idea. And of course with this outbreak now going sort of all over, like we will have to do lot of testing, especially on so we will have to focus on suspected cases, because otherwise just haphazard testing at hospital levels will not be useful, and that may be a waste of resources. Of course we'll have to do more, do community sampling separately, but that's a different issue. And also it is important to increase the surveillance sampling done at both at OPD level and as and inpatients levels. So in patients with respiratory symptoms, even though there's no contact history, I think it is important to do random sampling for surveillance purposes so that we have an idea where we are. Suspected patients, of course, we will have to isolate, separate, and take necessary precautions and test. And then if negative, then we can treat as otherwise or negative patient, but it's important to isolate and take necessary precautions. The numbers are increasing, so we will have to have we'll have to lower the threshold of testing. That's why we want to change the definition of suspected cases. Of the cases we had up to now, we haven't had any serious cases. Still, the patients are mildly symptomatic or asymptomatic patients. But as you know, most of the, as it was told in the media, a lot of these patients have low CT values, that which means that's an indirect indicator of the viral load, which means they have a high viral load. In other words, most of these patients are in the early part of the infection. That is the most likely reason for having this high viral load. And because of that, they spread the infection easily. And also, we will have to monitor them for some more time, because there's still, they haven't come to the, I believe they have, most of them haven't come to the stage of developing complications. So we will have to see whether all these will remain as mild patients or not over the next 5 to 7 days. So that is, I think, the important thing. At the same time, since we are getting more patients, it is important to make sure that these patients get proper care, and also the other patients also get proper care. So what we have seen is, due to fear, there can be delay in providing treatment for both suspected patients as well as other patients. So that we have to make sure will not happen. At the same time, it is important that healthcare workers, doctors, other healthcare workers take necessary appropriate precautions. I stress the word appropriate precautions to safeguard themselves. That is the most important thing. But what we saw over the last couple of months was taking unnecessary precautions, like partitioning wards, and separating them completely from doctors and nurses, so that no monitoring or supervision done at some places. And sometimes we were putting more stress on the equipments, monitoring and even drug or delivery or food delivery through equipments, which I don't think is a satisfactory situation. On the other hand, it is important to maintain the ventilation in these wards. That will minimize the complication of these patients as well as the risk of spreading the illness. So rather than partitioning these wards, it's important to keep the normal, keep good ventilation in these patients, in these wards, where the patients are being kept. In that way, we can minimize the spread also. That is what we have seen in our patients with the practices of our hospital. Probably the difficult places would be the OPDs and the ETUs, where a lot of patients come and a lot of patients with respiratory symptoms come. So it is important to take adequate precautions there. And also make sure that they get, because as we know, most of these patients are either recurrent asthmatic attacks or patients with COPD, bronchiectasis. Such patients are the common patients who come to OPDs and also also other viral chest infections. And we have to make sure that these patients get appropriate care, because at some places we have noticed that there had been delays in providing treatment. Of course, the strategies regarding the admission, whether to admit all or when to admit, those things might change in the future depending on the numbers of patients we get. So that of course we cannot decide at the moment. Those decisions might change maybe frequently depending on what we see. At present, the numbers are being catered and looked after, and also the rapid rise of numbers are now not there because that cluster is over now, but there are the people who had contacts with those positive patients are now getting reported as positives from various places. So we have to keep an open eye to detect these patients and to prevent them from getting complications, and also to prevent healthcare workers getting infected. Indika, that's all I thought of telling.
That's very important information, Dr. Anand Vijayavikram, because you highlighted the need that we should not be neglecting the care of other patients also in this situation. So there need to be proper planning at the case of how to manage those different patients and to cater for different possible scenarios that might arise. And also, though you highlighted the need for the appropriate precautions and not unnecessary precautions, and also appropriate testing and not irrational testing and screening. So all these are very important. Just one practical answer which may be useful for the doctors. Now, there's a directive from the Ministry of Health that if a patient has fever, to report to the hospital. So what should be the steps taken by a medical officer when the patient is reported with fever or maybe respiratory symptoms at the OPD? I mean, there are guidelines, but it may be useful if you can tell us very briefly.
I think since the respiratory, since we see patients from various places in the country, if there is, we have to look into the possible contact history, need not be a confirmed contact history with the patient. If there's such possibility, it's always better to do PCR testing and treat that patient as a suspected case. On the other hand, I don't think all the patients with respiratory symptoms should be treated as suspected cases, because as we all know, most of these other cases are due to other reasons, non-COVID reasons. So it is not necessary to test all the patients with respiratory symptoms. So still, even though there is spread, we know the spread is not very widespread. We see these contacts have gone to various places, but the spread from those places are still not much. Fortunately, we don't know, things might change within next 4 to 5 days. But at present, I think if there's a possible contact, then I think we should have a low threshold to test those patients. And until that, we will have to keep those patients as suspected patients. But on the other hand, we don't need to do COVID testing in all fever patients, because most of these fevers are due to other reasons. And we know I would like to stress that we see dengue patients now, and also we see leptospirosis cases now. So we will have to keep those two in mind, because if we don't take necessary steps, especially in leptospirosis, if we don't treat those patients early, they can die. So that we will have to keep in mind. So just doing a full blood count and a CRP would help us to differentiate such patients most of the time. Of course, if there's a suspicion, always separate that patient and do testing, not only COVID, do other testing, because we have to consider other possibilities, at least the full blood count and a CRP, which can be done in most places. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Ananda. Now, let's move into the preventive aspect. I would like to invite Dr. Kushlani Jayathilaka, who is a consultant microbiologist from the Sri Jayawardhanapura General Hospital, to remind us, maybe because during last several months it was noticed that certain preventive measures were not adhered in the way as it should have been. So, Kushlani, can you tell what are the possible preventive measures, and are there any changes in the strategies?
Right. Thank you. I think, as you said, we have been told this so many times, but I think we have to rethink about it now, because we were relaxing a little in the past, during the past few months. And also, I feel that some of the things that we mentioned, like, okay, a physical distancing, for instance, and that indicates, like, now, at least now, when we have a cluster, a new cluster, now we have to be careful. So we don't need to take chances and, you know, move about unnecessarily to different places, like even to the shops or wherever. You can minimize the visits which are not essential to public places. So that is important at this point. And also, when you go to a place, I think it is important how you behave. So people have not, realized it most of the time. They think that, the mask also, when they think that this is a requirement, for legal requirement, so they just have the mask somewhere, just under the chin most of the time, and they think they are... They don't think about the disease prevention. They are more about maybe to not to get caught to the police. So that is the idea. So I think the important thing is to educate the people, to give the real, to educate them and to tell them what to do exactly. So I think it is important that they have the distancing as much as possible. So whenever, now still our people are not now, they have forgotten to keep the meter, 1 meter, at least 1 meter, maybe better if you can keep 2 meters when they're having a queue. There's no queue most of the time. They just go to the counter. Everyone wants to go to the counter when they want to buy something, or when they want to go to the even to the clinic or OPD. They just want to walk just exactly. Everyone wants to be in the front and they don't want to keep a distance. So this sort of thing has to be again reminded and also implemented. Because even in hospitals, sometimes unless we check and... So I think it is important to give the responsibility to the head of the institution. And maybe it's mandatory to get them implemented legally if the head of the institution is responsible for implementing this. I think that would make a difference, because people are not educated enough. So we have to make sure that they keep they have the arrangements in such a way that they keep the distance between the people, and also mask to be worn properly. And hand hygiene, again, hand hygiene, they are told to wash hands. So they have sinks or whatever the facilities at the entrance of a shop or a supermarket. But when they go in, they are not bothered whether they touch the nose or whether they touch the mouth, and then they may be touching the goods which are there. So it is important to note that we have to clean our hands after touching our face and before touching our face, because the virus is not entering through our hands, but it is important to do it. You should not touch the face or the nose or the mouth. That is how it enters. So, and maybe eyes. So therefore we have to be like, people have to use the head and also to concentrate on what they're doing and to avoid unnecessary like touching of face, nose and mouth. And also to have the clean hands when necessary. Like it's good to clean their hands when they enter a place, but after that they have to frequently clean. There should be facilities to clean their hands before they touch the, if they have something need to touch the mouth or the nose, or after touching, in accidentally if they touch the mask which they are wearing or the nose, then they have to clean their hands. So this sort of concept is not there. They are just washing before entering, but after that, whether they touch the face or the mouth or the nose, they are not bothered. They are not thinking of cleaning the hands. So I have seen people, especially even in some supermarkets, when they are the people wearing the mask, they cannot keep it on. They have irritation and then they touch the nose. And then again, they are not bothered to clean the hands. So then it doesn't serve the purpose. So this is how, you have to be, people have to be very alert about this and educated. So I think it is probably not easy to educate everyone. So I think the legislation and the controls should be in administrative level. So even in institutions, it's not only having a wash basin outside and asking them to wash their hands when they enter, but they have to make sure that it is implemented inside. And also the more important thing is, if the people have any fever, or if someone is having fever or any respiratory infection, they should avoid coming to work. That's the most important thing. I think we all think about, especially the administrators think that we need to get people to work and they will have excuses to stay at home. But I think we should think now, by looking back, now you can see, if you neglect that and if you ask people to work with the symptoms, it will be more harm later. You will face more losses because then you'll have to close down the whole institution. So these are the things we have to think. I mean, it's not just to legally comply with the legislations, but also we need to think how to prevent in a rational way. So I think legal things also, we have to improve on the legislation, probably to get more give more responsibility and maybe authority and responsibility mainly to the administrators of institutions, hospitals as well as other institutions where people work, like in these factories. Any specific question you want to ask, Indika? Can you all hear?
Kushlani, I think it is important for you to tell people and also instruct the hospitals when to quarantine suspected exposed healthcare worker. Because right. I understand there is a pandemonium in LRH and unnecessarily right. Doctors and other staff had been quarantined.
It happens actually. Now, I think even in our hospital last time. So I think... your question, yes. I think our guidelines have to be clear, because earlier, even when our hospital had a few patients positive last time, some MOHs, like sometimes the MOH will decide that they need to be quarantined, whereas in other settings, they with the same condition, they decide that they don't need to be quarantined. So it was not very clear. Like whom to quarantine. I think in our country, we were overdoing it. It's true. But maybe like if you think of the WHO guidelines or guidelines in the world, now they have relaxed a lot about how long to quarantine, whom to quarantine, because there are now, especially with the PCR, we know that if the CT value is high, most of them may not be very infective. So there are so many things that we need to consider. So earlier we were very, very cautious, and I think we have taken a very high, threshold was very low to quarantine everyone who was in contact, in spite of having the correct PPE and sometimes unnecessarily. But on the other hand, at that point, I don't know. I mean, maybe we were we didn't have community spread and we didn't want any chances to be taken. Even now, still we don't have widespread community spread, so still maybe we need to have the control, but I think you all have to decide. I mean, the people who are taking decisions in the center have to give clear guidelines. That is the problem. So people, even now, sometimes the communication is also not adequate. I heard that we are getting calls asking whether we can take patients who are suspected and things like that. So I think there's a, maybe it's a little now, we have relaxed a little now with the new conditions. We have to again think of the current situation and decide on guidelines, how to quarantine, whom to quarantine, and how long to quarantine. And also about the hospitals to whom they have to be referred when there are positives. So at present, I think there's a little bit of slow communication as far as I understand, because even today I got some calls from people asking whether we can admit suspected patients and so on. So I think we need to do more. Maybe you all can do, Ananda, as you all are in the national level committees, you have to give clear guidance about this.
Can I just add one thing, Indika? Hello? Hello?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, can I just add one thing? Actually, in the technical committee, many months back, there was a decision and small committees were to be established within hospitals with the senior physician and microbiologist and a couple of technical people, maximum of 3 or 4 or 5 people, to have a small committee to decide on the quarantine and when to do PCRs. There was a guideline and it's still active, and guidelines are still there when and how to quarantine and to take decisions on exposed healthcare workers. And the committees which were established may be defunct now, but I think this is high time that the senior physicians, microbiologists, and infections control people in the hospital get together and establish that committee, maximum about 4 to 5, otherwise you won't be able to convene a committee on when you need it. The 3 or 4 people that can be contacted could take the decision, and a scientific evidence-based decision rather than different decisions on different people. So that is already taken almost about 5 months back in the technical committee.
Thank you, sir. Next, I would like to call upon Professor Neelika Malavige from Department of Immunology and Molecular Medicine from Faculty of Medical Sciences, University of Sri Jayawardenepura. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Sajith. I was asked to talk about the circulating virus strains because there is some talk of whether it's a new strain, how it will behave differently, and what are the implications. So I just want to talk about what we have done and just to clarify certain things. Can I just share my screen, please? Okay, so just to let you know what sequencing, how sequencing can help and how it can't help, and what you can learn from sequencing and when sequencing can't provide certain information. So basically, you can understand where the virus strains originated from. For instance, if you're having outbreak, like in this instance, where now there's a lot of talk going on and people pointing fingers at each other. So whether a particular virus came from India, Bangladesh, or Middle East repatriates, those viruses getting out. And also sequencing is usually done to see if the virus is mutating and if there are implications in transmission and virulence. And to, of course, how you can use it to contain a particular epidemic, which is used by many public health officials, epidemiologists in other countries. So as you know, I mean, this cluster I haven't put up here. So we had 4 big clusters in March, the CMC cluster in April, and the Middle East returnees, and the Kandakadu cluster. Of course, we had a Navy cluster. Although we tried to sequence the Navy cluster viruses, the viral loads were not high enough, the viruses we had to do that. So we have sequenced at different time points in Sri Lanka to see the Sri Lankan viral strains. So, and this is good because we can actually compare the virus strains that have been existing in Sri Lanka with the current virus strain to understand if the current virus strain is just something from Kandakadu or the Middle East spilling over, or whether it was imported from another country. So there is this global SARS sequence resource where this is an open source resource where all the viral sequences are uploaded to this website. It is not like uploading photos to Facebook. You have to submit your sequences, and if they are of high quality, they are an acceptable standards, they are uploading here, and you can use this facility to understand. So a lot of people use this facility, epidemiologists and scientists, to see the evolution and the transmission of the virus throughout the world and how it mutates and whether it's getting more virulent or not. So so the initial viral strains that we sequence in March, it's no surprise, which are over here and here, were similar to the ones in India and Europe. So that's no surprise. Then of course we moved on, sequenced the Mandaranayaka, the Middle East returnees, but just for your interest, the Kandakadu cluster, which happened in July, was quite a bit different from the previous virus sequences we saw in Sri Lanka. And when you, and with this virus resource that I just showed you, you can map, you can mix, you know, like identify the Kandakadu viruses, which one it matched most. And then we found a match. The closest match was in this area in India. And as you can see, the Kandakadu virus strains were very different from the other virus strains that circulated in Sri Lanka before, which means that the Kandakadu virus strains could have been importation during those months rather than a virus that was introduced in March or April circulating and mutating. So geographically, around the world, there are seven major strains. And when you look at Sri Lanka, these are the main strains that we have in Sri Lanka. And of course, so you might think that, okay, we have predominant this O strain, whereas globally it is less, but virus strains evolve with time. And so if you look at the world, the O strain has decreased with the increase in GR and GH strains. In Asia, the O strain has remained, but this is the situation in Sri Lanka with the GH strain predominating. Now, mutation and analysis. Again, what does this mean? So mutation analysis is important to understand if the virus becomes more virulent or less virulent with time. I think it's important to know whether it's becoming more or less virulent to understand disease severity, plan hospital facilities. And if the strains circulating in a particular country are very different from the strains used in the vaccines, then you have problems. Now, everybody knows about the influenza vaccine, and you have to give a flu, a new influenza vaccine every year because there is a huge change in the strains. So we know that there are so many vaccines being developed everywhere, and hopefully it will be developed soon so that we can end this problem. But we have to know the virus strains in Sri Lanka, whether they have are very drastically different to the vaccine strains to know if they're going to work or not. And of course, to know if the new strain is associated with increased transmissibility or response to antivirals. Now, of the things we sequenced, there were in the strains in Sri Lanka, there were a total of 153 mutations, nucleotide changes with 99 changes in amino acids. And so these are the comparison of the mutation rate in Sri Lankan viruses with other countries, and of course with various geographical regions. And the Sri Lankan viruses we sequenced had 153 mutations, and you can see that in Asian countries is sort of less mutated, whereas in Western countries there's a high mutation rate, especially with US. So this is depending on the rate of local transmission and also how the number of introductions of different viral strains from different countries. So that just tells you all that information. And of the mutations, the ones in the spike protein are most important. And in Sri Lankan strains, we have these two important mutations in the protein. And one mutation is extremely important, this D614G mutation. So when the SARS-CoV-2 epidemic started, we had this D614 strain, which was associated with a lower viral load. So this strain, if people infected with this strain, had a lower viral load. But later, this G614 strain took over. As you can see, the world started with this strain, but over time, this G614 strain replaced this strain with low viral load. So because this G614 strain came up later, it had a higher viral load and higher transmissibility. Now in Sri Lanka, 11 out of the 19 viruses sequenced had this G614, which is this strain associated with high viral load. So not many strains in Marsh, but in Kandahartu, all the viruses were sequenced had this mutation, which was associated with high transmissibility. And there is this, among the strains in the world, only one mutation has been identified that is associated with low virulence. And so far, the viruses up to now, not this particular cluster, did not have that deletion. So now just to end by saying how the mutational analysis can help epidemiology. So the SARS-CoV-2 mutates as a approximately 2 nucleotides per month. So when you identify, let's say we sequence the viruses in this cluster, then if it's from the Kandahartu cluster leaking out, then we can know how many mutations should be there from July to now, and it should be the same viral lineage. And to see if there have been multiple introductions. So if we are talking about this particular cluster, is it just one cluster, or have there been several introductions of viruses by doing sequencing? Is it local transmission, or was this virus actually imported from India? And especially, a lot of epidemiologists use these strains to see if it's the same cluster or different ones. And so this is just one study from Netherlands, how they have identified to see the extent of community transmission. So when you have so many different types of viral strains, that actually indicates the level of intensity of community transmission, if there is any. And especially in the case of healthcare-associated infection. Now we know that already one healthcare worker is in LRH is infected with the virus, which has caused a little bit of a problem. So, and if by any chance there is a healthcare-associated infection, in order to take preventive measures in that hospital, you would want to know, is it a healthcare-associated infection, or was it from a patient? And many individuals elsewhere, infectious diseases, epidemiological modeling, use this sequence to actually, you can model the exact number of people infected to find out if you need a lockdown or not. Now, having said that, this is what viruses are sequencing used for. And actually, right now in this the problem we are facing, it doesn't really matter what strain we have. In order to contain the epidemic, it is absolutely important that we take the precautions that Dr. Kushlani and everybody else highlighted, because people are talking a lot whether it's a new strain and what is going to happen. I mean, we can identify all the things that I just mentioned by sequencing, but right now the priority is to actually take precautions to avoid this epidemic. So we did all these things in our lab, and these are our two sequencing machines, and these are all the people who are involved in the sequencing. So that's it. Sajid, do you have any questions? Or
asking whether there is a place for antigen testing at the moment.
Okay, so antigen testing, now that's about diagnostics. So there are so many antigen, there are different types of antigen detection methods right now. So some of the so-called antigen detection methods, like the Abbott machine and so many other things, are actually a LAMP-based platform. It is not just detecting antigen, but it is a different type of amplification of the nucleic acid, which is a LAMP-based assay. And I'm happy to say that SleenTech has developed a LAMP-based assay very successfully, which we have validated using over 300 something samples in our laboratory. The IDH hospital, Dr. Malika, provided over 100 samples, 132 positive samples for testing, and it has performed very well. So that is one type of antigen-based assay. And there are so many other types of antigen-based assays. And of course, certain assays can be of low sensitivity than a PCR. Not the LAMP assay. LAMP assay is very highly sensitive. But what is important is, now, if of course, as Dr. Ananda said, it's absolutely important to do all that. But then at the same time, because of limited resources, no country has enough resources to just to screen the community and find out extent of spread and that sort of thing. So in such situations, it might help to use antigen testing if you find suitable test. So this is just my opinion, not anybody else's, and open to discussion. That was just my opinion about antigen testing. Thank you.
Thank you. There's one more question coming up. That is, after getting the infection, how long the antibodies will remain in the body?
Antigens, I believe.
The question is about the antibody.
So after getting an infection, the antibodies will remain. Now we have followed up individuals who were infected in March up to now. So that is like, I think, 6 months later from March. Yeah, so even 6 months later, those who had severe illness, which were not many, and those who had prolonged shedding. So if you remember, our initial criteria to discharge from hospital was two PCRs negative 24 hours apart, which meant a lot of people stayed in hospital for a long time because they would not stop shedding the virus. So such prolonged shedders and those with severe disease still have positive antibodies even after 6 months. That is not the case with those had mild infection. Those with mild infection, about 50% of those with mild infection lost their antibodies around 3 months. Quite a few of them, I mean, there is no evidence of either antibody responses or T cell responses to the SARS-CoV-2 at 6 months in those who had mild infection.
Thank you, Professor Neelika. Then we'll be moving into a different area.
Thank you, Indika. Thanks for inviting me. Before I start, I want to congratulate the other two speakers, but particularly Professor Malivige. Because why I think, you know, particularly as a researcher, doing local research and, you know, taking decisions based on local evidence is extremely, extremely important. And it was a great talk, you know, quite a lot for us to learn as well. Well done, Neelika. So I have been asked to talk about stigma, which I'm pretty sure, you know, all of you know about stigma. In Sinhala, it's very difficult to find a proper technical term, one term. A lot of people say venas kota salakima, if not apavadatmaka, hasirim, akalpa, that type of wording. I don't know, I'm sorry, you know, Tamil words. But it's important, first of all, as all the participants to understand what stigma includes. There are mainly three components in stigma. One is perceived stigma. To give an example, if somebody is suffering from leprosy, that person might feel, that's entirely individual based, that other people would discriminate. So it's the perceived stigma, which is maybe actual or not actual. But the second component is public or social stigma, where the other people, the way they think, way they behave towards a particular illness or a person. So that's the social or public stigma. The third one is structured stigma, which is mostly through institutions, and also it's partly to do with what the system entails. To give you an example, structured stigma could come from healthcare sector, media. So these three are not necessarily mutually exclusive, they are overlapping. So all three are very important. Now, when it comes to perceived stigma, people, not only leprosy like TB, AIDS, all that, if somebody is having it, they might feel that, you know, they have been discriminated. So therefore they wouldn't go to mix with people, they would avoid. Basically, that perceived stigma anybody has would affect the way they think about themselves, the way they behave in the society and mix with other people or not mix with other people. It's the other way around in public and social stigma, where the society treat these affected people negatively. They might discriminate. For example, there had been reports where people have been thrown stones at COVID patients. Usulu isulu karanna saying this COVID hadicha minihage daruwa and type of thing. And the structured. Now, the most important thing, all three aspects of this stigma is involved in COVID. We need to understand that. And right now, for me as a behavioral scientist and as a psychiatrist, what is happening right now, because we know people in the health sector, now Ananda did his maximum with all the other colleagues in terms of treatment. So Neelika, you know, was involved in testing, the political leadership was there, the army was involved. It was a success story. But I think relatively, the public has failed to deliver their duty, take their duty and responsibility into their hand. I'm not blaming them. If children do something wrong, the parents are responsible for that as well. So this is something which we need to very, very seriously reflect. Now, recently, compared to the other previous clusters, we saw people have been avoiding. Avoiding for many different reasons, perceived stigma, public social stigma, structural thing. So we have to be very careful in dissecting out the issues. In my opinion, mobilizing people has relatively failed because of this stigma being affected in many different ways. And stigma comes also through the doctors. As Ananda said, you know, if somebody has respiratory thing, so certain doctors and nurses may be worried to be involved. I mean, with great respect to great majority of healthcare professionals have done an excellent duty, but people may, based on what they understand, have a little bit of prejudice, worry, concern. And in handling this, we have to be very, very careful using fear as a health promotional tool is wrong. That will only exaggerate the stigma and have a negative impact on it, for example. And it wouldn't work. For example, if you try to sell COVID and saying, be careful, people might die, that message wouldn't go very far because people know that, you know, over the last 2,000 cases, we have lost only one life. So that's a wrong health message to combat this challenge. And again, I have heard from, you know, many people scaremongering, which actually aggravates stigma, saying there aren't sufficient ICU beds if this spreads. And we know only a small majority, Ananda will be able to give statistics, ended up in ICU beds. And as we all heard, you know, in my opinion, quarantining would be sufficient, not necessarily even people who are positive don't have to be hospitalized necessarily. So as Ananda said, these policies may change. But all these add to stigma, particularly the way things happen. For example, every person who is quarantined doesn't have to be shown in the television. The numbers doesn't have to be breaking news. So media has a very positive responsibility, which they have done in a magnificent way compared to what was during tsunami, but still there are negative behaviors in terms of, you know, showing every quarantine place, which will have a significant impact on stigma in all three ways. People perceive that there is a structured stigma and quarantine shouldn't be perceived or made to be understood as a punishment. You would remember people saw if people don't have a curfew pass, they are sent for quarantine. So then it's perceived as a punishment, not as a preventive health measure to prevent further outbreaks. So it's complicated in a way. So my message, we need to combat stigma. In doing so, we need to educate the public and we need to educate every stakeholder who is involved in this, about these three components, how our actions, even in very good faith, may bounce. Because at the end of the day, the cognitive theory is that the way people think determines how they feel and how they behave. So even in good faith, if the quarantine is done, if people perceive it as something, as a punishment, or which is involved with stigma, people will behave in such a way and they will avoid. That's why they hide. That's why they they, you know, try not to. And again, remember, as doctors, as even patients, we know sometimes people get into denial. If somebody is diagnosed with a cancer or a diabetes, they might try to think, you know, they don't have it. So we have to be very careful in whatever we do, not to have a negative consequence which exaggerate perceived public, social, or structured stigma, because that can affect. So the other way around, understanding all this can have an impact on engaging and involving the public. They are two different words altogether. Engaging public is one thing, but making the public involved is another thing. So we need, as medical professionals, transmit down to the grassroots level. It has been done to some extent, but in my opinion, the behavioral strategy should be in the forefront. Anand, I'm proposing to you, even in the COVID center. In fact, I wrote a letter to, you know, the top level people about it as a proposal. We need to get psychologists, behavioral strategies into the COVID control center in order to try and understand. And based on research, as you know, I mean, we are following up this, the whole cohort, and we have interviewed people. We have done in-depth interviews, which gives classic examples, how they feel, why they are frightened, why they avoid, why they don't want to be, you know, known as a patient. So all this is, again, like Neelika's findings, we have evidence-based approaches which we can use. So to give you an example, then engaging and involving and empowering the public may again have many different approaches. To give you an example, I generally name and shame when things are not done right. I went to Laugh recently, Laugh supermarket. The security person told me, when I asked him whether he has a thermometer, he said no. About sanitizer, he said, Nasser, boru ada. So then I said, you told it to the wrong person. I took a photograph of him. I took a photograph of Laugh and sent it to the health top man in Colombo district with a complaint. So people need to challenge. If somebody is not wearing a mask, when I go to a queue, if somebody comes and try to jump on my shoulder, I challenge them in a polite way. And that has to happen at every stage. I went to a hospital this morning to see, you know, some people are, as our consultant microbiologist at Javadanapura mentioned, they have the mask, but for the sake. So making people understand it, legislation, rules, punishment, all that, those are effective, true. But the bottom line, you may remember when helmets were first introduced, people were carrying helmets in motorbikes, they didn't wear it. So we need, because we have to get the notion that we have to live with COVID for some time. As Neelika said, even if a vaccine is found in other parts of the world, it may not necessarily work for us. We have to live with COVID. And this challenge demands a huge shift in behavior, thinking, attitudes. Wrong attitude is like a flat tire. Unless you change it, you can't proceed any further. So again, when it comes to now, thinking about this garment factory, I think the top has to be held responsible for failing their duty, for not protecting their employees. So the trade unions has a big responsibility not to demand salaries, this and that, at this type of juncture. At least demand for the basic requirements, thermometer, sanitizers, checks. If the management doesn't come up with, they have to come up with a proposal saying, this is our life. This is our society, and this is our people. We need these facilities. So I'm trying to link all these to the notion of stigma, because at the end of the day, when things go wrong, that will only enhance this stigma, which will have a negative impact on people. And again, you know, some people I have heard, and we have sort of heard in research as well, some people think the great majority wouldn't die. It's low virulence, so that's fine. So what if I stay home without declaring, going to a doctor? So health education has to be a fine balance, because I remember as a medical student, Health Promotion Bureau was offering Bulat Athan saying Marayagin Aradhanayak. That was a completely wrong, culturally wrong message, because Bulat Athe is not a Marayagin Aradhanayak in a single hour of the time. So that message go wrong. So I think we have to, my last plea to everybody, top to bottom, we need to carefully plan risk communication strategies which can have a behavioral shift from policy planners, politicians, downward to the public, that will challenge the discrimination based on stigma and avoidance and the whole system approach. I'll stop there, Indika, if there are any questions. Happy to answer.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Sumadipala. Just one quick question. What do you think about, at the moment, the role of media? What do you think about media going full steam during next few days or so regarding inculcating best practices and preventive measures and putting full energy onto that aspect?
Yeah, I think media has a huge role. Although I highlighted the negative aspect, the great majority, the media's role would be a very, very positive thing. But it should be a calculated, a concerted effort. Say, if I have authority, what I would suggest, all the media at the same time propagate the same message, dedicated discussions, you know, cut down on some of these other what I call nonsense programs and give short and sweet real health education by people who are competent to communicate and who understand the principles. Sometimes if you give too much of details about, now, for example, if Professor Neelika Malavige does this presentation in public media, you know, people will be confused. That's at to a top level. But she will be able to communicate the same thing at a different level to the public. I'm pretty confident about that. She can do that at a different level. So the health messages using media, it also should be structured around a strategy rather than, you know, different people coming and giving sometimes mixed messages. So my plea, Indika, I think the SLMA has a big role sending messages to, you know, trying to work with them, workshops, work with them, not giving or imposing things. But I have to say the media is playing a great role compared to tsunami, my personal experience. They are great, they are good, but there is provision to improve. And media has a big role, and SLMA has a big role as well. At the same time, I think the COVID center itself has a big role. The politicians have a big role. And media can be used very, very positively to disseminate this and engage the public.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Muthupala, for that visionary words and regarding the way forward. Now we are coming to the end of this very important and useful discussion. There are a few questions that have been asked. I'll put them together and maybe ask from the resource persons. One is regarding, now there are so many patients have been detected in different parts of the country. Have we moved into the community stage of transmission? Can anyone answer? Maybe Manoj Veerasinghe, can you tell us about the definition of community transmission at the moment? Can we tell, or is it too early? Manoj, are you there?
No, I don't think still we can call it a community transmission, because basically we are still in the stage three. Because if it is a community transmission, we need to get regular patients from the community where we cannot link to a previous case. So that is not the case at the moment. As far as I described at the very beginning when I was talking about the current situation, up to now from something about 1,100 cases that we have detected, I think about 99% already they have established a very clear link to this particular Brandix index place. There has been a couple of cases that they are still investigating, and it's very unlikely that it's premature for us to tell that we have gone to stage four. So it's a cluster epidemic as far as I can see from the last 6 days. But it does not mean that it cannot spread. There is the potential, probably of the 17 districts that we have seen involved in this, if this, the movement of those cases in these districts, if they have gone places and they have contacted people, which we still have not been able to trace, there is a possibility, but it's too early to tell. It's a community transmission. It's very clearly defined yesterday by the epidemiologist also. We are still seeing a cluster epidemic. I think that is something which we have to think about. But the responsibility lies between stage 3 to stage 4 for all of us in this country. The health system forces are trying to contain it, but whether we can contain it or not depends on the support that we get from health workers, all other government servants, plus the public. So it's a collective effort that we, if we prevent it to from stage 4, it's a collective effort, and that is where we should try our best. There's no doubt about it.
So can I add to that, Manoj?
Yes, sir.
I think it's a very, very important statement you made. Even the learned professionals have misinterpreted this. I heard Sudhat explaining. And this can be a very nice risk communication message to the public, because what some people feel that, you know, it's reporting from all over the country. They perceive it as a community transmission. So what we can, as a health risk message, say exactly what Manoj said. It's the prime responsibility of every citizen to prevent it becoming a major calamity in the country, and therefore empower them to say, not because of anything, people may not necessarily die. It's not the quarantine which is become an issue, but if this spread, the whole country will be affected, economy will be affected, and everything would be affected. So it's the prevention which should be linked to. Thank you very much, Manoj. It's
and just one, I would like to add something. Actually, Professor Sumathipal has said, people avoiding the health sector because of stigma. From what I understand, I think some of the statements came from different places that people are avoiding may not be 100% correct also. For example, there has been problems of actual contacting those who were the Brandix cluster and infected, because there has been certain issues of the system-wise where the contact details have not been updated. So but when somebody tells this in good faith, it's reported in a very negative way in some media, stating that these people have gone in hiding, which is not really correct. So what has really happened is some of the people could not be contacted because of the contact information. There has been some mishap. So that is one part. That is why within about 48 hours from four days, now it's almost everyone is contacted and they have come up. It is not that they have gone hiding. If they have gone hiding, they should be still hiding. So we also should be responsible from the media side, and if anyone who tells things in the media, to say that if you have not known about the status, please come back, rather than threatening them, which gives a very wrong impression across the total population.
You are 100% correct, Manoj. This is exactly, unfortunately, the so-called freedom of information has gone wrong, you know, in this juncture. People think freedom of information is to propagate every lie and what they think. So that's again something, Indica, when SLMA takes up, you know, these things with the media, should make a plea to them to say that, you know, be cautious.
Some colleagues from media who are attending this meeting as well. So maybe some message, so that, I mean, they are doing a great service. So Absolutely. There are areas for improvement, and these may be things that they can consider. And there was one last question regarding the availability of clear guidelines for different situations.
Whatever the issue is, that the guidelines have been done. many times, and it has been updated, and it has been posted in the websites, and some has been delivered to hospitals and healthcare workers. But there is a bit of a gray area to what extent we take proactive interest in getting those, reading those, and adhering to those. So the whatever the guidelines we do, and if the healthcare people are not aware about it, and if they are not proactively going through this and adhering to this, there's a bit of an issue. But the general guidelines for public is very clear, and it has been already given 1,000 times in the media. So the I think healthcare workers from that end also should be responsible in accessing those guidelines and getting familiar with them.
Thank you, Prashant. Now we are almost concluding. Are there any final messages, one short messages that the speakers want to share?
Yeah, even stigma, there are guidelines by the ministry, Indika. The comprehensive guidelines.
Yeah, they are very comprehensive. Yeah, yes.
I think guidelines should be updated now. There are novel treatments also after these recovery trial results and new drugs. Like remdesivir and all, like I think guidelines, the treat management part, section should be updated. And on the other hand, like you know, the staff quarantine is it should be a very careful process, because it should be very scientific. Because now we experience a big problem in Gampaha. There are about 26 medical officers are under quarantine, institutional quarantine. Few others are home quarantine, under home quarantine, and also many other staff members. So the running the hospital is a bit of a problem there. Some wards are closed. So this will be seriously affected in the patient care, because we have to manage other patients, like other illnesses. So so this should be a very scientific, and also second contacts is a also important, that our families, I am also under quarantine now, institutional, and even my families had also under quarantine. So it's like second contacts, and there are the most of our in this group, they are sitting for the grade 5 scholarship and A level, and this is a bit of a problem.
Indika, can I add to that? Indika, yeah, I just want to mention something about the hospitals that I think someone was mentioning about the people are not.
Definitely, I think this is a huge issue, and
To come to hospitals because we have to make hospitals a safe place. Otherwise, people are scared to come to hospitals. So that is issue that we have to think carefully. I know there's a problem about quarantine, and maintaining the services is an issue, but we have to balance this carefully so that as we discussed, there are guidelines, but the guidelines need to be updated. Again, about the quarantine guidelines, again, there are several issues now. Even in Sri Lanka, still we sometimes depend on the testing for when you want to release the COVID, the quarantine. But I think there are other guidelines now saying, we know that PCR is a very highly sensitive test, where even the people who are positive with PCR, maybe they are not always infective. So there are options that we can discuss, and we have to upgrade, update our guidelines, so that maybe the quarantine can be, quarantine guidelines. That is why I said the central guidelines are needed. So we say that, okay, it's true that there was a message from the ministry saying that we need to have committees, and we already had committees by then. We have committees in our hospitals functioning on COVID steering committees, but to take the decisions, there should be national guidelines. Based on national guidelines only, the institutions should take their own, do their risk assessment and take the decisions. So therefore, the national guidelines have to be looked into and to be updated according to the, because we have new evidence now. Currently, we have more evidence than what we had in March or April. So therefore, we need to look at all the guidelines and update them, the management as well as infection control, So that has to be done, and also the ministry has to again get the monitoring of the implementation and look at the new guidelines. So that is important. The monitoring is important. So that is why I'm saying the hospitals, usually we have our infection control committees in our hospitals. Infection prevention and control is actually happening in hospitals rather than in other places. So that is why I'm telling, my opinion is that even in other factories and in other institutions, they should have their own health and safety committees. Somebody looking at only health and safety, so that they will catch these people who are having symptoms, active surveillance on infections in the workers, that sort of active surveillance and looking for, I mean, possible cases, that should be done. Now in hospitals we do that. We have a committee working on, like, full-time infection control nurses are working in prevention and control of infections. And for COVID, we are doing a special surveillance, auditing, everything had been in place. So I think in a way, our hospitals are safer than other institutions. So we have to do the same in institutions, all institutions where people are working. They should have somebody to look into the health and safety of the workers. I think that is very, very important, because then we can monitor and implement the guidelines. That is something that we have to think about. Thank you.
Thank you, Pushtani. And with that, we come to the end of this very important session. And I thank all the speakers for sharing their valuable knowledge and the expertise.